Hi, I'm Tom Beaupre of Florida Georgia Line, and you're watching for BassPlayersOnly.com.
Hi everyone, John Liebman here. You're watching for BassPlayersOnly.com. We're coming to you backstage at the DTE Music Center, formerly known as Pine Knob. Have you ever played here when it was called Pine Knob? Oh, us longtime Michiganders know it as Pine Knob. You might even see some people with t-shirts saying, I still call it Pine Knob. Really cool logo. Anyway, we are hanging out before the Florida Georgia Line show with FGL bassist Tom Beaupre. Hey, Tom.
How are you guys?
We're doing great. It's great. It's great to see you. Thanks for taking a few minutes to sit down with us, because I know the folks want to hear all about you and the band and all kinds of cool things that you've got going on. But let me start right from the beginning. You've been in Nashville for quite a while, but you grew up in Pennsylvania. Tell us about your musical upbringing and how you first became a bass player.
Yeah, so I actually started in elementary school in like third grade. And we did like the big music farm, and I was just immediately drawn to the upright bass. So I started, that was pretty much my first instrument outside of like, you know, a little piano that I'd probably quit within the year. But I stuck with the upright all the way through college. I played in the orchestra my whole career. And then it was probably, I want to say like middle school, I started electric bass. And so I've always just kind of been drawn to that. And so you had mentioned influences like Edgar Meyers right off the bat, Christian McBride, those guys. Christian's a Philly boy. Adam Blackstone, a bunch of Philly guys that are just killer upright players. So I've always really been drawn to that, and so then from there I picked up guitar like every bass player does. So
usually it's the opposite.
Right, yeah, you realize how much better the bass is.
It's usually because you play guitar, you want to play guitar. But there's more than enough guitar players in the band. Yes, you play bass. What's a bass?
Yeah,
you want to be in the band? Yeah. Well, then you play bass.
That's right. Yeah,
that's my story anyway.
That's a lot of common tale, especially you get to Nashville and you're like, wow, these guys are good, I'll just play bass. And then you realize it's not that easy.
But it your story is a little bit unusual, because not too many people, I've interviewed, I don't know, over 600 bass players, and not too many of them start with the bass. A handful of them do. You said you were drawn to the bass. You just saw it in the band room in school, or what?
Yeah.
Or was it the sound, or had you even...
I think it was like, I mean, obviously the magnitude of an upright bass is kind of like cool, and then like even when I hear a song, when that low note comes in, it's just like this rumble of ooh, you know, it's just like immediately I get goosebumps, and I'm like, that's why I play bass.
So you're talking to people who understand.
Yeah, you know, so that I'm sure the teacher picked it up and was like, dum dum dum, and you're like, yep, I'm gonna learn that. It's a lot cooler than an oboe or a flute or something, you know, in my opinion.
I imagine it was a little bass. It's a big instrument, but you must have had a little one, I'm guessing.
No, it was like twice the size of me. And like, we had to fold like all the seats down in my mom's car. And I don't know why she said yes to me learning this thing, but it was always a challenge to get.
Now she knows why. And now I'm sure she's happy. So you studied classical technique with the bow, Simandl method, all of that stuff?
The French technique. I never got in the German style bow. I tried in college and it just felt so awkward, because I'd played, I love the anchor with the pinky on the, you know, so I was just kind of stuck with that. But
I'm just the opposite. I started with the German bow, and people have heard me say it a million times, when I pick up a French bow, I hold it like a German bow, because that's what I know.
A lot of guys love, like, the, you know, they say they can dig in harder with the German, and I just felt like I could push and control dynamics a little better. Mm-hmm. And that's just personal opinion.
You mentioned Christian. I've interviewed him a couple times. Adam Blackstone, I did interview.
Oh, really?
I think I might have reached out to Edgar Meyer. I know he went to Indiana University and he was in the orchestra and all that. He's, I have seen him perform a couple of times. But you must have been listening to a lot of the classical guys too, like a Gary Carr maybe, or Francois Rabaf, or Thomas Martin.
I wish I knew you earlier. I would love to.
You know me now.
Yeah, I know. I was like that guy that I didn't ever like dig into, like, who was that playing. I was just like, I really like that, I'm gonna learn it. And then it wasn't until like high school or college where people were like, oh, you know, so and so played on that, and then he played on these six records, and I was like, oh no, that's cool. You know, like, I should dig into the person, not just like, oh, I like this bass part, you know? And
so in hindsight, the music that you liked in high school, looking back on it now, who were some of those bass players?
So
you can tell me who the bands were. You
know, obviously, I grew up, I feel very fortunate. My parents had pretty good taste in music. So like Sting all this time was like a staple that my parents would have in their little six disc changer.
Cool, parents.
Yeah, right? Graceland, you know, so like.
By Gaty Kumalo.
You know, some great, you know, and Roscoe Keith was telling me he was building a fretless for him. And I was like, dang, that's awesome. So I got really fortunate on, I guess, what I was exposed to, you know, James Taylor, like a lot of classic, just great, talented people that I didn't know who it was or why I loved it so much.
So Leland Sklar and then yeah. Jimmy Johnson.
Exactly. So you're just like, man. And you know, it's like, look further down the way, I'm like, Willie Weeks. Oh, wow. You've played on 90% of the things I loved. And like, you know, those guys are, you know, James Jamison and, you know, Marcus Miller. I got super into him and started digging into him. And he has a great documentary about playing with Miles Davis when he was like 18 and started like exploring his whole catalog. And like, big into the gospel world too, like I love that. So Justin Raines and all those guys.
Yep. I've interviewed all those guys you mentioned.
Yeah, so
except James Jamerson.
Well, yeah,
And Willie, we're working on Willie right now. He's out with Boss Gags right now, and mostly in Europe, and then they're doing a U.S. leg.
Cool.
Yeah, he's also one of my favorites.
Oh man, that Donny Hathaway. I mean, it's game over in there, you know. Best of the best.
Well, let's talk about your current gig.
Yeah.
Well, maybe you can start by leading up to that. I know you're in Nashville. At one point, you were roommates with the guys, right? With Brian and Tyler. And tell us the story.
Yeah, so I randomly filled in this random gig in actually like Cleveland and Cincinnati and met the keyboard player at the time, who ended up a year later meeting the guys after they graduate college. So I needed a spot to live, and we all just ended up living together. And they were just writing songs as songwriters and had this.
Was it just the three of you or anyone else?
There was Chase Rice, who's also an artist. And then, so there was five of us. Yeah, so Brian Tyler, Justin Ruzick, Chase Rice, and me.
All living together?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. And ended up just like, they were like, man, we got all these songs. We want to go play them in town. And so we would just play local things. And we did a Relay for Life and, you know, the local bars in Nashville. And
on Broadway.
Yeah. Well, no, we stayed away from Broadway. We actually did like.
Congratulations.
Yeah. I know. I feel very fortunate. I didn't have to play like the 5-hour sets, you know. That's just got to be exhausting. So Chase Rice became an artist. The guys formed Florida Georgia Line, became an artist. And we would tour. The two artists would just hire one band. So we'd all just tour together in a van, and they would only have to pay one guy, one bass player, instead of like, you know, it just made everything really easy. So it was fun. So we would just play pretty much the entire Southeast, and then things really quickly took off within 2 years, 3 years of being in a Tahoe to a van to, you know, all of a sudden cruises out, and I like have a substantial gig in Nashville, you know.
Well, what was the tipping point? What was it that hit the spot with the audiences?
I would probably accredit it to Sirius Radio. They have the highway.
Okay. 55.
Yeah.
Is it?
I think that's right. So Cruise was
listening to all
phone.
Kinds of music.
Yeah, you got it.
Especially after my daughters had my car. But
yeah. So it became the highway fine, and it just like the shows. All of a sudden, we're like 50 people to 120, and we're like, how did all these people know our songs? And I was like, oh, we heard you on Sirius Radio. And so that was a huge tipping point. And then when they signed the record and the record deal with Big Machine, you know, they got a producer on board who just, Joey Moy, who's produced Nickelback, a ton of big bands. And all of a sudden, it went from like a cool song to like, oh, wow, you guys have something special. Like, I'm glad to be a part of this. And that, you know, from once it hit radio, it was, I mean, we went from probably selling 100, 200 tickets to like 1,200. And like, it felt like overnight. And I was just, I remember being in, actually, Detroit at, shoot, what was that venue called? Anyways, I remember selling, we sold 1,200 tickets. And I looked at BK and I said, I worked for this band, Thousand Foot Crutch. And I said, we're selling more band or more tickets than the band I worked for like 2 years ago. Not a dig on them, but just like I saw them as a huge band, and all of a sudden I was like, whoa, we're equal to like selling more tickets than they did. Holy crap, I think I've made it. You know, it was like that moment where you're just like the realization of like the success is happening, and like we're on to something, and the crowds are showing up, and the shows are fun, and you know, I felt like my mom was like, I think you're going to be okay. You know, like maybe this move worked out for you. So it was fun. It was a fun couple years to kind of see how it works so quickly. And just going from clubs to arenas, like within 2 years, it was nuts. You know,
well, you were the opening act before you came to this prominence for other, it was with Taylor Swift, I think, and a bunch of others.
Yeah. So, I mean, like 2000,
that didn't hurt.
No. 2012, we opened for Jake Owen and we're doing, you know, House of Blues type venues.
Yeah.
And then the very next year, we're opening for Taylor Swift at Dallas Stadium to 55,000 people. So it's kind of like a what is happening moment, you know? Like, I was, what is the band with the Wonders? What's that movie?
That thing you do.
So there's that moment where all of a sudden they pan and it's just like thousands of people after they were in a club, like the scene before. Like, I had those moments where I'm like, how did we get here, you know? So it's just a fun ride, and feel very fortunate to still be here. So
did you hang out with Amos Heller during the
tour? Actually, funny story, I just had a kid 6 weeks ago now. And he filled in for me. So Amos is a good friend and a heck of a bass player.
Yeah,
I apparently have some licks to learn after he filled in.
We did an interview with him at Summer NAMM that we haven't published yet. It's in the vault. We'll have to bring that out. It was a good
vulgarity. Is that why
he didn't strike me that way at all?
No, Amos actually taught me a lot, and he is just like such a true professional. It's awesome, and I really appreciate everything Amos has done for me. And he came in here like no one missed a beat. You know, it was great. So I'd be curious to hear that interview.
So would all of us. Tell us about your gear. You mentioned Keith Roscoe earlier.
So I had a friend turn me on to Roscoe, and I play all of their stuff because, I mean, they're just some of the most incredible basses. And he's just been so generous to kind of help me out, especially in a hurry. All of a sudden, we had some gigs 2 years ago that I was like, Keith, I need an entire another rig, because we have A and B rigs because we're flying all over the place. And he's like, I got you. And so it really helped me out. Fender, I've been with Fender since 2012. They're always great. They're just such a big company, you know what I mean? I can, it's just tough sometimes, you know? Like, they've been bent over backwards for me, but to have like a personal one-on-one relationship with Keith is just awesome. So
I talked to him yesterday, as a matter of fact. He's a great guy. I
love it. Ben at Fender's been nothing but generous and super helpful to me, but he also deals with probably 3,000 artists, you know? So, they've been great. Keith's been great. So I play their stuff. And then Kala.
The U-Bass?
Found that in L.A. at a same mesh. And our guitar player was like, dude, you got to plug that in. And I was thinking, this is like cool little toy. And I plug it in. I was like, what the heck is this?
That's everybody's first impression and then subsequent reaction.
Yeah. So I toured with that for the last 3 years. Played on a song called Sundays.
I mean, guys like Billy Sheehan and Leland Sklar, people you wouldn't think of, they play the Kala U-Bass also.
And so their rep actually reached out to me and was like, hey, we'd love to make sure you got everything you need. And they, same thing, bent over backwards for me.
Nick, okay.
He just actually was in Summer NAMM and came over to the house because I had just had the kid and brought us dinner. So Nick,
big, you know, tall fella.
Yeah, very tall. Yeah, I'm sure he gets that a lot. But super, everyone, I've just been very blessed with the people I work with at all the companies. And, you know, it comes down to the relationship. And I want to work with people that are willing to help me, and I can help them as much as I can. And I take that really seriously. And I try not to chase gear. Like, if I need it, I'll play it. But I also want to make sure I really have a good relationship with the artist and or the artist rep. So
What about strings and amps, maybe effects, if any?
Yeah. So I've always been a Mesa guy. The 400 plus, in my opinion, is the best thing ever made. So I worked with Tim McKee over at Mesa for years and years.
Okay.
And then Dunlop does all like our accessories and my picks. And then we're with Diodario with strings. And that was, that's been great, yeah.
They would use the NYXLs by any chance?
I think so.
Okay. Because I know they were really excited when they released that line, Diodario, and everybody seems to love them.
My tech kind of handles all my strings, and so I'm like, I'm terribly out of the loop on that. But no, I'm like, if it's great, don't tell me. Like, I'll let you know if there's an issue. But I think I'm pretty sure that's what we've been playing for the last 2 years now. They've been great.
Yeah, you're not the only one. I interviewed William Duval from Alice in Chains. Yeah. So what kind of strings do you use? He's just, I don't know that the techs handle all that.
No, Cal's been great. He really knows me well and what I want. And so I was with Ernie Ball for a long, long time. Uh-huh. And then they all were like, hey, you're the only one not with Diodardi. Do you want to come over? And I was like, all right, fine. So I went over and I was like, you know what? AB them. Don't tell me when you change them. Because, like, for me, mentally, it was like, I played Ernie Ball since I was 12. And so if I knew it wasn't, I would probably have an opinion. And I was like, I hate to say this. I have no idea. They both sound great. I couldn't tell you the difference. And I've been very, very happy with Diodario. And they all sound great. And they play well. I haven't had any, like, inconsistencies with strings. I know a lot of bass players complain about that, especially with, like, your low B. Sometimes if it's not, like, wound tight enough. I've heard a lot of guys, and maybe I'm not, like, attuned enough to my strings, but I have never had issues and never broke a string, and I feel like...
You never broke a string?
Never.
How long have you been playing the bass?
Apparently, I have a gentle touch. Yeah, and so, like, I've been very happy with everybody. Everybody treats me very well.
Well, you're a very likable fellow. You know, a friend of mine did a similar test, but it was with two or three kinds of vodka. Let me see which one.
We do that every night on the bus with whiskey.
Okay. Let's move on. I do want to ask you about bass technique and about playing bass. I mentioned we have over 600 interviews on For Bass Players Only. Recently, we also added an education component, and we have several loads of courses right now and lessons on learning bass.
Cool.
And I want to ask you what advice you can impart to somebody who wants to learn to play the bass, maybe professionally or maybe just for fun, or maybe it's just something they've always wanted to do. What do you think is important that everybody should think about when they want to take up the bass or they want to become a better bass player?
Ooh, that's tough. I would say to start, like, just pick a song and start learning, because I think a lot of people get hung up on, like, well, I need to know strings and notes and theory, and it's like, just start learning. I think I heard Victor Wooten talk about this once. He said, like, if you think about it like language, you don't start out with full sentences. You start out with, mm-hmm. you know, like, you say one word at a time. And I see that as, like, okay, just learn a song and then learn why that song works. You know, why does that sentence make sense? Same kind of thing, where it's just like, start learning so it's fun for you. Because I see so many guys just like, I'm tired of practicing scales.
Yeah.
Well, stop playing scales and play some songs that are fun.
Play some music.
Yeah, play music.
Something that feels good.
Yeah, and then if you learn something that's like, you can go back. Like, you can learn the Stevie Wonder song that's like, you know, a pentatonic scale in triplets. All of a sudden, it's just a cool lick. And then you reflect on it and you're like, oh, that's really cool. He's using a lot of theory there. And then you can break it down that way. So after the fact, I feel like makes it a little more fun because you already are playing music. And so I would just say, start playing. You know, get on YouTube's ridiculous what you can learn on YouTube. On websites like you guys have, I wish I had that, you know, when I was learning. Because you can get on and see some of the top guys kind of break things down and make it fun for you instead of sitting there doing your finger scales, you know, 1, 2, 3, 4. You know, like, that stuff drove me crazy and probably prevented me from really digging in until I was a bit older. So
Tom Hamilton from Aerosmith paid me one of the biggest compliments I've ever gotten. He says, I wish your resources were available to me when I was coming up.
Yeah.
So I said, wow, thank you, Tom.
Yeah. No, honestly, because it's just like, it's cool to see someone. And then teachers always have a very specific way and want to see the progression, especially with the theory side. And so to be able to just like go on a tangent of Snarky Puppy or like, you know, yeah, there's so much you can learn, which can be a bit daunting, but at the same time, I feel like it at least gets people playing, and that, I think, will motivate you to learn why you're playing what you're playing. So I love it. Thank you for doing that.
Thank you. Thanks for the thanks.
Yeah.
No, in my online lessons as well as my books, I approach everything from a groove standpoint. So even if you're playing your string crossings, your arpeggios, your scales, I do it in a way that is designed to be musically satisfying, musically rewarding, fun to play.
Yeah.
And that's why I say you're having fun while you're getting good, and you're getting good while you're having fun.
Right, totally. I actually took lessons from Justin Raines a couple years ago.
Okay.
I was just like, felt like I was in a rut, and I was like, I'm going to pick someone that gives lessons online and just really force myself to dig back in and like make my brain think musically again. And that was his biggest thing, was like, if you're gonna learn, you know, a pentatonic scale or do some sort of exercise, like, have a beat, like, find a drum loop and just play to that, and then it just makes it fun, and you can kind of like change it up and make it feel musical instead of just boring and technical, you know.
Yeah,
it's cool.
Yeah. Justin's a good guy. We hung out at NAMM a year or two ago.
He's a talented guy.
He sure is. What about the future? What else is coming up? I know you're pretty ensconced in your current gig. Oh, hey, do you want to talk about your other business?
Yeah,
okay, yes, I've almost forgot. Yeah. You are, was it the president of a wealth management company targeted to musicians or something like that? Why don't you tell, what is it?
Yeah, so
what's the name of the company?
It's called Nashville Private Wealth Management.
Okay.
And it's we have a couple offices all over the states, in Virginia and Florida and Louisiana. But really, I just saw so many of my friends and other people just kind of handle money poorly and not know who to ask. And so instead, you know, you go the path of least resistance, which is typically to do nothing. And so I just wanted to find a way to kind of help my friends and my peers. And so I got all licensed up. You know, it took about a year.
Got all licensed up.
Yeah. It took about a year and a half of studying. You know, it was like a 6-hour test, the first one. And
What? Fiduciary?
Yep. Yeah, just, you know, wealth management and like all the rules and regulations. And so I got all my licenses and then just met up with the guy named Bob Obratus, who started this company like 25 years ago, who took me under his wing, and he has a passion for music too, and did something similar for songwriters, and was just loved the idea that I wanted to help. And so he's just kind of really been a mentor, and we've just tried to really dig in to the music industry as a whole and really just find a way to help musicians handle money, you know, and like plan for their future. And the last thing you want to do is tour successfully for 20 years and then have to go get another gig because you didn't save. You know, like, it's easy to get in the moment and just go play golf and buy beers and buy whiskey, but you know, it's really simple to kind of set yourself up for 20 years from now and be able to put your feet up in golf because you retired, you know. And so that's just my main goal, is to kind of help my friends and my peers really plan for their future. Because
how do you juggle both of your roles there?
Well, you know, we tour Thursday, Friday, Saturday, so I work typically Monday through Thursday as much as I can at home in the office, and then I don't play till night, so there's Wi-Fi everywhere and I can always make phone calls and send emails during the day while the market's open. And then
how do you manage that? Thursday, Friday, Saturday is the only times you perform?
At least
for the most part.
Yeah, for most tours, like, it's pretty regular.
That's why you're here tonight, and you were just here 12 days ago
at
this very same venue.
Yeah, so it makes it
easy. And both of them were sold out.
I know, right? It's been a fun tour. Yeah. Been a lot of people showing up, which is awesome. So it makes it easy for, you know, me to send text, emails, phone calls, and keep up with everything, keep up with the financial world as well as the music world. And yeah.
Are you big in Europe too, or other parts of the world?
We did Australia in March. We were over there for 2 weeks. We did Europe.
You didn't go over on Wednesday to do Thursday, Friday, then come back on Sunday.
Well, luckily, we, you know, the office has a bunch of people that can help me out while I'm gone, and we got a great staff of people that really take ownership over like my clients and really fill the gaps if I'm not available. So we have really knowledgeable and talented people that have been doing it far longer than I have, that just really, you know, go above and beyond for all my clients. So it's been awesome.
Because I interviewed Rhonda Smith
one
time from Jeff Beck and Prince and all those folks, and I asked her another interest that she had, and she said, I'd be a stockbroker or something. Some people don't know. Well, I didn't want to say it exactly because I want to ask you this question. It's kind of my signature sign-off question.
Yeah.
What would you be if you weren't a bass player?
Apparently a financial advisor.
Okay.
Yeah. I mean, honestly, that was always kind of my other option. I was always drawn to it. So I said, why can't I do both?
Had a feeling you'd give me that answer. Well, this is great. Congratulations on all your success.
Thank you.
And we're looking forward to the show tonight. And good luck with everything.
Thank you for interviewing me and taking the time. And I do want to, can I say one more thing?
Depends what it is.
Well, I think people are always really fascinated by this. So I actually don't have a bass rig on stage. All I use is a Subway DI. And so it always, people are always kind of blown away by that. But I think it just goes to show you don't necessarily need a big bass rig, but also it goes to show you how good the Subway DI is. That's always a fun fact.
I think it was John Cowan from the Doobie Brothers. And we were sitting like over there somewhere. I don't know where. We did an interview here, and I asked him about his equipment, and I got to amps. He said, don't use amps on stage. Yeah. And it's not as uncommon as a lot of people would think.
Right. Yeah, that's always like kind of the one that blows people away. It's like literally a pedal board is my rig. And then, I mean, but it helps to have 16 subs that are big as your house. You know, but
But that's somebody else's problem.
Yeah, exactly. No, I had a rig for like years and years, and I just felt bad that I was either carrying 80 80 pounds around where my tech was. And finally I was like, I don't even hear it. You got in-ears in. Let's get rid of it. And it's been great. Haven't looked back since.
It's funny. My son got married a few months ago, and I got up and sat in with the band, and my other son did also, and he didn't have an amp. Really? At a wedding. And yeah. They put the in-ears in me, and it was just a sign of the times, I guess.
Yeah, exactly. Yes. Exactly.
Well, thanks again, Tom. Good luck. Keep doing what you're doing, and much luck and continued success to you always.
Thank you.
Backstage at the DTE Music Theater with our good friend, Florida Georgia Line bass player, Tom Beaupre. I'm John Liebman. You're watching the essential resource for one-on-one bass player interviews and more people's favorite site for learning bass online, for bassplayersonly.com. Once again, I'm John Liebman. Thanks for watching.